Broadcasting from Salisbury University campus, this is WSDL Ocean City, NPR News Talk 90.7. Putting Delmarva first. Stay tuned for Delmarva Today with your host, Don Rush.
It's been nearly 15 years since that fateful day when planes crashed into the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. Most people can remember where they were, what they were doing when they first heard the news. Welcome to Delmarva Today. This is Don Rush. It was a clear blue sky in New York City when word first spread that an aircraft had struck the World Trade Center. A short time later, another did the same. Eventually that day, both towers would fall, sending up plumes of rubble and dust. While in Washington, D.C., the Pentagon found itself with a giant hole in its side made by another aircraft. And in Pennsylvania, there's a memorial where a fourth plane hit the ground after passengers struggled with hijackers. The United States went to war, first in Afghanistan and then in Iraq. And 15 years later, we are still engaged, with drone strikes spreading out into other countries, including Pakistan, where the Taliban beat their retreat from U.S. forces in Afghanistan. Osama bin Laden is dead. Al-Qaeda appears to be a bit of a shell of itself, and another group known as ISIS has established itself in Iraq and Syria. We've had an Arab Spring, which seems to have brought down the old Arab dictators, and the Shiite-Sunni divide has made international borders almost irrelevant. This morning, we want to assess where we are. In studio, we have Dean Kotlowski. He's a history professor at Salisbury University. On the phone is David Mack, former U.S. ambassador to the United Arab Emirates in the Reagan administration and deputy assistant secretary for the Near East in the State Department in the first Bush administration. He's currently a scholar at the Middle East Institute. And from Delaware, we have Muqtada Khan, the founding director of Islamic Studies at the University of Delaware, as well as professor of political science and international relations. Well, welcome to the program, all.
Thank you.
So I want to first start just briefly with each one of you to talk a little bit about where you were when you heard the news. Ambassador, I'm going to go to you first. Where were you when you first heard the news? What was your impressions about what this might mean for the country in those first hours?
Well, I was 5 years out of active service with the State Department and the U.S. Foreign Service. And I was working as vice president of the Middle East Institute, an educational organization in Washington, D.C. I was there at the Middle East Institute when the word came.
And what was your thoughts as to what it might mean at that moment? Or did you realize, I mean, what were you thinking?
At that moment, I didn't realize the full dimensions of what had taken place. That only became clear subsequently. With the attack on the Pentagon, the clear indications that this had been coordinated by terrorists to deal a major blow to the United States. I'm afraid, fairly obvious to me from the beginning that it was probably connected in some way to the Middle East, where I had spent my entire career in the U.S. Foreign Service, and I knew about the tensions and hatreds and animosities that often got focused wrongly, in my view, on the United States, but it was definitely a reality.
Muqtada Khan, where were you when you heard the news, and what was your reaction to it?
I was in class. I was teaching a class in political science from 8 a.m., and while a janitor who passed by said, planes are crashing into World Trade Center. And at first, I didn't believe what he said, and he repeated it. So I called my wife on the phone, and she turned the TV on, and she was horrified. I mean, she was literally crying as she told me what happened. So I took my students. It was a small class. This was in Michigan. I was teaching at a school called Adrian College, and I took them down to the common room where there was a TV, and we watched the second plane actually hit the building. We were quite horrified, and the students were in a state of shock. So I spoke with them, and then the class was canceled. I came home, and I actually went and wrote an article, and it was published the next day, and the article was, if this was done by Muslims, then I wrote a list of things that I expected would happen anticipated a crisis of civil rights in this country and a spurt of wars overseas. But it was a moment that I probably will never forget. And I realized that that it was going to have a tremendous impact on Muslim relations with the U.S. Even though early on, while there was speculation, somehow I thought that Muslims were responsible for this.
Dean Kotlowski, where were you at that morning?
I was a at the time I was a second. It was in my second year here at Salisbury University. I was an assistant professor. I was getting ready to teach a class at 11 a.m. in Old Carruthers Hall, which is no longer here, replaced by the new Academic Commons. And I think it was around 9:14 or so in the morning that CNN broke through with news of something that had happened in the World Trade Center. And from what I remember, they weren't sure if some sort of bomb had gone off. You just saw some smoke coming out of one of the buildings. I was getting myself arranged. I had to teach the class at 11 a.m. By the time I left, it was clear that there were two planes that had hit the World Trade Center. And I think when I got into the car, I was listening to the news, and that's when the news that another plane had gone down in Pennsylvania. And at some point in there, there was also the Pentagon. I went to the class, and I asked the students if they had heard what had happened. Back in 2001 at Salisbury University, unlike today, where every classroom is equipped with computers and things like that, this was one of the ones, fortunately, that did have a computer. And we were able to get a television signal, and we were able to watch it. At some point, very early on, like maybe 11:15 or so, somebody came through the hallways and said all classes are canceled. Hmm. So what I did was to go home. I was glued to the television set. I watched the news. I also watched some changes here on campus. As the campus went into a different mode, there was going to be a celebration for the 75th anniversary of Salisbury University. That got canceled. I think it may have been pushed back a year. And then we all got into a mode of trying to understand what happened. And replacing, to some extent, that celebration, not a direct replacement, but sort of what displaced it, was a lot of concern. Memorials, obviously, concern about students, and even a teach-in that was organized, almost, you know, it sounds like something out of the Vietnam era, but again, teach-in in not so much to oppose something, that's what we sort of would think of with Vietnam, but, you know, in the act, to learn something, to have experts, you know, on campus answering questions from students and the local community.
As a matter of fact, I mean, I remember I was in Washington, D.C. working for another public radio outfit, and I remember getting actually a call from my wife because I was actually in some cubbyhole of an office and said, hey, did you hear about the plane crash? And I said, no, really? And I turned on the TV, and a short time later, as I think a lot of folks did, I saw the second flight hit the World Trade Center, and of course, later on, we saw the smoke from the Pentagon. And I remember writing a line about how everything had changed, that the world was going to be changing dramatically, and that nothing would be the same. Let me turn to something that I think is of significance, and that is, for our discussion, I guess it's been called Bush Doctrine. I found this quote by the former president. And he said, our war on terror begins with Al-Qaeda, but it does not end there. It will not end until every terrorist group of global reach has been found, stopped, and defeated, end quote. I want to turn to you, Ambassador. What do you make of that doctrine, and how has it survived, do you think, over this long haul of some 15 years?
That's a very perceptive question, Don, because like you, I was in Washington, D.C., I was following very closely, as I'm sure you were, the approach that this relatively new administration seemed to be taking toward the Middle East and other Muslim countries. I was relatively hopeful, based perhaps on my misunderstanding that George W. Bush was going to be rather like his father, George Herbert Walker Bush, who had distinguished himself, I think, by working very hard for peace and security in the Middle East and doing it in a way that meant the United States was helping pull together a coalition of governments in the country, Arab governments, Israel, other Muslim governments. My own feelings, and I, in this respect, I kind of empathize also with Professor Badarkhan. I remember at the Middle East Institute, we, of course, had Muslim employees, Jewish employees, academics, experts, as well as Christians and non-believers. And I remember one of the Muslim employees coming to me, an Egyptian-American, saying, "I pray it's not Muslims who did this." That pretty much was my view, too, I think, because I recognized that what were essentially political disputes could become channeled into religious extremism by various parties, and that this would make them deeper, more personal, more inclined to avoid any kind of compromises or peaceful settlements. And I was, as I say, initially very hopeful about what the Bush administration was going to do. I had served twice in Iraq, and I'd served in Libya and Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, other places, and had been actually married in Jerusalem. So I was kind of keyed into all the issues in the Middle East. And what started out initially, I think, with a very hopeful policy by the Bush administration that was more the tone of the Bush administration's approach rather than to specific words on paper. But for example, I was at the Islamic Center in Washington, D.C. when President Bush spoke there in a mosque type, a mosque environment with all of the Muslim ambassadors invited, other people who were involved in the Middle East. And I thought he spoke very well and very movingly, as he did publicly to the American people, reminding them that this was not going to be a fight with Islam. It was a fight with terrorists who were misusing the religion of Islam for their political and criminal motivations. I felt the Bush administration started out very hopefully, but I did realize early on that it was going to change the focus of U.S. policy in the region. U.S. policy in the region had tended to be dominated by two causes. One was to try to arrange a peace between Israel and its Arab neighbors, especially Israel and the Palestinians, that would involve security and a just and dignified future for all of them. And the second pillar of our policy, the second focus, was on trying to maintain a stable and hopefully more progressive order in the Arabian Peninsula and Persian Gulf. It became clear, unfortunately, as time passed, that the issue of fighting terrorism would take precedence over those other two foci, and that this would cause the United States to enter into arrangements with some very authoritarian governments often and do other things that would be counter to its traditional strategic objectives.
I want to turn to Mukhtar Sadr here. Mukhtar, because I ran across a quote, Mukhtar, from an Islamic writer who said, quote, "The United States all but declared war on Arabs and Muslims, ensuring that the terrorists who numbered in their hundreds would soon spawn thousands more in a much scarier iteration." First of all, do you agree with that? And what do you think went wrong here?
Well, if you look at what really has happened since then, clearly that that quote has proven to be prescient. I think that the initial response of President Bush was obviously admirable, and he comforted the nation, and he clearly made very sympathetic comments about Islam and Muslims, etc. But subsequently, the actions, I think the Bush administration underestimated the meaning of what happened on 9/11, and then they clearly overreacted, and you can see the collapse, the complete collapse of the Middle East today as one indirect consequence. To give you an example, in the many conversations after 9/11 that we had as to what has made Muslims so angry, there was this constant reference to the state of the Palestinians or the rather statelessness of the Palestinians as one of the reasons why so many in the Muslim world were becoming anti-American, and they saw America as the sole supporter of Israeli occupation of Palestine. And look at it now. We are nearly 15 years away, and that state remains, which means that the foreign policy errors that the U.S. was making in the Middle East before 9/11, which led to 9/11, continue to remain in place. And new errors have been added and compounded, which is the war in Iraq, which has clearly destroyed a country which had nothing to do with 9/11. We in the United States, a few of us do talk about it, but the population doesn't realize that we were responsible for the destruction of a nation which led to the deaths of over a quarter million people, displacement of nearly 4 million people in Iraq and subsequently Syria, etc. So we are culpable to some extent in the deaths of literally hundreds of thousands of people, and this is, again, our foreign policy. And the results are visible. You can see, to some extent, the destabilization of Europe as a result of Syrian refugees and emergence of ISIS. ISIS is Al-Qaeda 2.0. So before America's response to 9/11, you had Al-Qaeda 1.0, and after America's response to 9/11 overseas, now we have Al-Qaeda 2.0 ISIS. And if we do not, again, make corrective measures and deal with this issue, especially now we are compounded with the rise of Islamophobia in Western societies, so there is a lot of anti-Muslim rhetoric coming from people like Donald Trump, and not just Donald Trump, but, for example, when Newt Gingrich was running for office in 2012, he seemed to have only one issue, and that was the World Trade Center mosque, basically demonizing and saying that Muslims have no place in America's sacred places. And so there's this constant barrage against Muslims coming from prominent Western leaders, including now the Prime Minister of France, etc., continues to alienate millions and millions of people. And the state of affairs in the Muslim world is getting so bad. The governance is really absent. I mean, if there is any place in the world where there is no governance, it is apparently the Muslim world. And then there is the youth bulge, and literally 400-500 million youth jobless, angry, frustrated with the global order, upset and angry at the United States. And then the appeal, or the religious appeal of groups such as ISIS, who couch their terrorism and violence in misappropriated sources from the Quran and Hadith. So right now, I think that things can get even worse than what we have right now with all these refugees coming into Western countries and then experiencing Islamophobia could further radicalize and generate recruits for ISIS and other groups. And I think that unless some wisdom prevails, it is going to continue we will have to pay a tremendous cost. What we have not realized is that the financial burden of the post 9/11 policies has really handcuffed our future. We are not as economically stable. We are not even as modern as we used to be 20-25 years ago. our infrastructure needs to be invested in. We need to. Our own society has become increasingly divisive to the point that America is also suffering from some of the malaise of the Middle East, of ungovernability. Our politicians fight among themselves to such an extent that they, to a great extent, even undermine our own national security by the way they go after our president and so on and so forth. So I can see that there seems to be like an avalanche effect since 9/11 to a great extent in the Middle East, really. They're the biggest victims. The amazing aspect of this is that Muslims continue to commit acts of terror, even though Muslims are the biggest victims of terrorism, not just in terms of loss of life and loss of property, but loss of stability. Muslim nations are collapsing. We have more failed states there than ever before. But it also is having a deleterious impact on U.S. economy, on U.S. society, on U.S. culture, and Europe also.
Well, Connor, I'm going to stop you there because I want to turn to Dean Kotlowski, because one of the things that has struck me is that there is a, for lack of a better word, a certain isolationist strain that's now emerged after some 15 years of military engagement. We had Hillary Clinton, the Democratic presidential nominee, the other night say no more troops in Iraq or no troops in Syria, meaning, of course, large contingents of troops. What do you make of what's happened in the body politic in terms, because the thing that seemed that really struck me particularly about Donald Trump, the Republican nominee, is that during this primary run-up, he basically denounced the Bush administration approach to all of this.
I think that's been most shocking, and there have been analogies that people have made, I've made, between Barry Goldwater and Donald Trump. When it looked, you know, a few months ago, like Donald Trump would be beaten overwhelmingly. And you'd have to go back to Goldwater to find the last major party candidate who said anything critical of the last president of the same party. He had made some veiled comments about Eisenhower, but Eisenhower actually appeared in a campaign commercial for Goldwater. So it wasn't the same thing. It wasn't the same degree. On the issue of isolationism, I think one way we can take this is to think back to 9/11 and the way this was analogized for the American people by commentators. There were a lot of comparisons with Pearl Harbor. The shock, you know, the fear, the sense, maybe it was just a veneer, but of national unity and a desire to come together and put trust in government. Certainly, looking back, there were signs in both cases that maybe something was up. We had no idea exactly what was going to happen. And both things changed, both events changed the trajectory of American foreign policy. And it seems to me that Pearl Harbor was much more of a straightforward and enduring change where isolationism ended for the time being. I mean, this big debate. And America was engaged in the world in World War II, the Cold War, the post-Cold War era. And like you said, this is the first election where that seems to be at issue, where we're actually having a debate, where it's not a debate within one party and things along those lines. And it seems to me that what happened with 9/11 is certainly, like I said, a change of trajectory of American foreign policy. But and I think the other commentators are talking about this in different ways. Something that's more muddled and maybe less straightforward, because in a way the U.S. entered war, but also metaphor about a war on terror. And it's you're fighting a phenomenon, as well as Don, you said earlier, tying this with Iraq and Afghanistan. There you had governments and, you know, the Taliban, nation states, things that the U.S. was fighting. But with the war on terror, in some ways it harkens to some of these domestic wars on poverty, on cancer, on the energy shortage. Under Jimmy Carter, he called it the moral equivalent of war. And that quote you read from Bush, I mean, that gives you the sense of how open-ended all of this was. So it's almost like we didn't enter, some people maybe thought we were entering into a period like the 1940s and 1950s, where there was going to be this overarching thing, this war on terror that was going to define American foreign policy. It was going to be something perhaps like World War II, the Cold War. And what we got instead was this kind of metaphor-type situation that we're fighting in. It's more nebulous. It's more open-ended. It's more difficult to get a handle on for a lot of people. And simultaneously adding on to that, these kind of more localized, which become regionalized, quagmire-type situations that are not exactly like Vietnam but are somewhat parallel to Vietnam. So rather than entering into the 40s and 50s, it's almost like America, in a strange and odd way, re-entered the 1960s with devastating consequences for, getting back to your original question, the party in power and the administration in power.
I want to finally wrap up with this. There's, of course, we place a lot of emphasis on ISIS. And when I hear from reports, the territory, at least, that ISIS now has begun to shrink. I ran across a quote by a longtime Islamic State operative who said, "While we see our core structure in Iraq and Syria under attack, we have been able to expand and have shifted some of our command, media, and wealth structure to different countries," end quote. Ambassador, a lot of emphasis has been placed on getting rid of the territorial caliphate. What do you think that might mean in terms of our approach abroad? Because a lot of folks are almost thinking that this is going to be a victory and that somehow something really significant is going to happen. Do you share that view?
No, I think that getting rid of the territorial caliphate is getting rid of one very dramatic but probably transient result of this, of some of the general trends that the two professors have talked about. Professor Badrkhan would be able to tell you much better than me, but in the long, long centuries of Islamic history, this is not the first time that there has been a self-proclaimed caliphate in the Islamic world. And in fact, back at some point in the Middle Ages, around 1200 or something in our calendar, there was in fact a very autocratic and despotic and vicious regime that embraced roughly this same area from in the upper Tigris and Euphrates basin, including Mosul and Raqqa. And it lasted for about 75 years. And it did, it was horrible for the people who were there. It was destabilizing for their neighbors. But now it's a little footnote in Islamic history. And I would say that this so-called Islamic State, and I will not even dignify it by calling it by the names that are usually used, although I like the Arabic Daesh better than some of the American usages, but this so-called Islamic State doesn't really have much to do with Islam, and tried to exploit religious feelings on the part of many people for its own purposes. And secondly, it's becoming less and less a state with the, aside from carrying out executions and levying some draconian taxes in areas that it controls, it's not really doing those things that a state would be doing, and certainly not what the population in places like Mosul and Raqqa thought they were getting when this came in, and they saw it, perhaps many of them, as a preferable alternative to the neglect that they had faced, and neglect and probably repression that they had faced from both Baghdad and Damascus. So I think the idea of eliminating the territorial state is, this is very good for Syrians, very good for Iraqis, very good for their neighbors. But I think in the long run, it's not going to make that much difference. We are still going to have a long-term struggle with organizations that are roughly spin-offs in some way or another of the original Al-Qaeda as it's metastasized. And they are going to exploit grievances and tensions and hatreds wherever they find them. And I think that that is a reality of the 21st century that we're going to have to live with for some time to come. Americans, this is really hard for Americans to accept.
Ambassador, I'm gonna have to stop you there because we're running out of time, but I appreciate that. I want to say that we've been speaking with former U.S. Ambassador to the United Arab Emirates, David Mack, under the Reagan administration. Also, he was Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Near East in the State Department in the first Bush administration, as well as currently a scholar at the Middle East Institute. Also from Delaware, we had Mukhtar Khan. He's the founding director of Islamic Studies at the University of Delaware, as well as a professor of political science and international relations. And also in our studio, Dean Kotlowski. He's a history professor at Salisbury University. Appreciate all of you joining us this morning on this very important topic. This has been Delmarva Today. I'm Don Rush. Thanks for listening. Ruth Starr Rose was an Eastern Shore artist, and she brought to life the lives of the African Americans who lived here. Welcome to Delmarva Today. This is Don Rush. Ruth Starr Rose lived in the Hope House out towards Easton, and it was there that she began capturing the faces, the lives of the African American community. But it was a time when Jim Crow segregation was taking hold. She was born in 1887 and lived to see its end, including the civil rights legislation in the 1960s. But her artwork endures, from black and white images to full color paintings. They include portraits in which the faces of those she painted look out with an everyday dignity. Others capture the life and activities of this community, including iconic religious images. Curator of the collection on exhibit at Salisbury University is Barbara Paca, who also ran across this work as an art restorer. Also in our studio is Miss Frances Curtis, who is a relative of one of those who is depicted in these works. And well, first of all, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having us.
So let me start with you, Barbara. So explain a bit about how you ran across this very unusual set of art pieces, and they were clearly not all in one place. They were kind of scattered around. How did that happen?
Well, I think like any good story, it was just so refreshing to see people of color portrayed with dignity and respect. And the more I saw, the more I wanted to know about the community.
Yes.
And the artist who was portraying interesting people. So it led to really meeting people like Mrs. Curtis, who's sitting here today, and learning about her family and their histories, and weaving that together with the stories we had of our families to tell the story about One Maryland.
Mm-hmm. So what? Tell me about the first painting that you ran across. How did that happen?
I was in the studio of the conservator Kenneth Milton in Chestertown. And he had been working on a very large project for about a year of European paintings, and was rifling through the racks one day. It was a routine inspection. I was with my friend, who's the dean of international affairs at the New School, Professor Krusheva, and we were just seeing which ancestors our friends were finally restoring, and pulled out a masterpiece of a very young, beautiful, self-confident African-American woman. And so our first question was, who is the great African-American painter on Maryland's Eastern Shore? And we were corrected. We were told it was a white artist, which we both found remarkable. Nina, coming from Russia, and myself coming from California, thought this connection between person portrayed and artist is quite close and seemed unique for that time. And so we learned about the artist. I had started working on that property, strangely, as a landscape architect to interpret the four centuries of landscape architecture and design. So when the conservator said the surname of the artist, I connected the dots, and it helped me understand what happened, the magical things that happened at that property in the 20th century.
So what you saw this picture, which I guess is described as the Black Mona Lisa, what was your immediate reaction? What drew you to it?
It was a beautiful portrait. I mean, it was first of all, technically it was beautifully painted. The brush strokes are fine. The gesture, the portraiture was beautiful. But it was showing a woman who was really the visual representation of Gertrude Stein's story of Melanctha Herbert. It was a person who's clearly domestic staff, but had great hope and had boundaries. She knew she was attractive, but she knew that people couldn't cross lines of respect with her, and if they did, as Gertrude Stein wrote, she had a tongue that could be very nasty. So, and I liked that. I liked that strength that was inherent in this beautiful woman.
Now, she is actually part of a whole family. She turned out to be Anime Moni. Tell me then a little bit about the family and how that family interacted with Ruth's family.
Well, the family is incredible, and they are one of the founding families of color in America. They originally lived on the hill in Easton, Maryland, which we now know is America's oldest extant free black neighborhood in the United States. So they were quite smart. They were quite successful. It's a huge family. It's a very closely knit group of people. And they respected Ruth Starr Rose's family, and there was kind of a mutual respect, I guess you could say, that was beautiful and continues to this day between among the descendants of Ruth Starr Rose and the Moni descendants.
Do you have a sense about what drove her initially to paint these portraits of these particular people? I mean, she could have painted anything.
Yeah, she was just an incredible woman. I mean, she was just relentlessly positive. And she told all of her friends, she's studying at the New York Art Students League, and she's telling her friends in New York, what I'm doing is original. No one's done it before. And I'm determined to portray people in a positive manner. And we have a lot of correspondence between the artist and her friends in New York. And they're really encouraging her to do this work. And they would come down, her friends would come down to the farm for long vacations and loved the people that were living there. And it was, you know, in one of the peninsulas of harshest segregation, some of the worst history we know, people getting along and sharing a community.
Well, let me ask you this. So there's a whole slew. I talked to Jeffrey Moni, and one of the things he told me about was he would look at, for instance, there's a portrait of his aunts, and he said he could look and he could see in that portrait the things that he saw of them, obviously, when they were much older, and he didn't know her, obviously, as they did were then, but he could still see those expressions.
That's a beautiful story, and kind of ironic, because the day that painting arrived, someone called and said that someone wanted to sell it. And I knew from the description of that painting that it was important. It was exhibited in a very important show in the early 30s with Georgia O'Keeffe, Thomas Hart Benton, Chagall, Picasso, and Mondrian. So we knew it was important. And so the painting was delivered. Someone was carrying it, two little girls, about 7 and 9 years of age. And Mrs. Curtis, who's sitting next to me, immediately said, I went to school with that girl. That's Pauline Moni. And she was absolutely right. And the age of the girl is the age of the student when she met her. So.
Well, let me ask you, Francis. So when you saw those, what did you think when you saw that picture?
I couldn't believe it.
Yeah?
I couldn't believe it because I didn't know most of her other relatives. I knew her and maybe a couple more from church, not my church, but local churches. And then I just looked, and she was surprised. She didn't know that I had relatives down there, and I didn't know that she had. So it was surprising. And then we started corresponding Christmas or...
Mm-hmm. What were these two like? Do you remember? The two women, what were they like?
Oh, Ruth and
they
Pauline.
They were really nice people, nice, talented people. Because her aunt plays for our church.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, plays the not the organ, whatever.
Yeah, or what, yes.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then her several of her other relatives came over to our church, mm-hmm. and they live. I know they have, they go to church in town where they live, but since she plays, they come to
on a regular, on a regular basis.
Yes.
Now there's another lithograph, which I guess is, yeah, go ahead.
And she sings.
She sings.
I have a very good, have made tapes and things on.
So I'm trying to, there's a lithograph, I guess it's the Madonna. Tell me, Barbara, a little bit about that. And I mean, it's a unique thing to it. But first of all, describe what we would be looking at if we saw the picture. There's actually a couple of, there's actually, I think it's the workup, I think, before. Tell us a little bit about that.
So the Madonna is a beautiful black and white lithograph of a woman watching her child sleeping, a little baby sleeping in a cradle. It's called the Madonna, and in the artist's notes, she wrote to her friends in New York that the baby kept on moving his head and his legs, and it was driving her mad.
Why?
But she said, I'm trying to show the power and emotion of a mother protecting her sleeping child. So we thought that that was quite beautiful. Eventually, we actually were able to locate the cradle that the child's featured in, and we purchased it, and we took it back to the conservator, and he said, this is an 18th century American cradle. This would have been one of the family heirlooms at Hope that the Starr family allowed the staff to not only bring their children to work, but to have them sleep in the same cradle that their children slept in. Mm.
What did it say, do you think, about the relationship between these two groups of people?
It's just a powerful, powerful relationship, trust, and mutual respect.
Good.
Mm-hmm. So what these portraits, I mean, they many of them look out at you. Many of them are very individualized. What does it say about her attention to detail and the way she captured these people's everyday lives? So there was one portrait, I think, there was a man who's holding a gun.
Bernard Mooney.
That's
Ms.
right.
Francis knew Bernard.
Yeah, I mean, what did it say about her sense about who these people were?
She, in the portrait called Duck Hunter, which is a gentleman called Bernard Mooney, and he's holding a shotgun, he's ready to go out hunting. He's wearing the clothes that her brothers would have worn when they were going out hunting. He's holding a decoy that's carved by the Elliott brothers, so it belongs in the Ward Museum. So she's showing him as an equal to her brothers, engaging in the same activity that her brothers would have engaged in. And again, if you look at Carl van Vechten of the Harlem Renaissance, writing about Gertrude Stein is portraying for the first time people of color not as a spectacle or entertainment or an event, but just people leading ordinary lives. That's what this artist did with a paintbrush and her lithographer's stone.
Hmm. So now she also tries to capture the way they lived. I mean, many of the activities. Describe some of those for me.
She wrote again that she was working on a project for 10 years and that it was to show the productive daily life of the people who lived among her family. So we have crab pickers, we have oyster shuckers, we have people harvesting crops, people working in tomato canning factories, people making sales.
Yes.
And everyone, she traveled to Charleston, and she did a beautiful painting called Charleston Flower Sellers. And when we took it down to Charleston, we took the image down to the people at the Gibbs Museum, they said no one portrayed flower sellers like this. They are always looking kind of oppressed and caricaturized. And in her painting, it's a beautiful depiction of people very active, very focused on their work, and working harmoniously. There's a color palette that's bright, but it's not patronizing, but it's appropriate to Charleston and that period and people selling flowers.
So, and in the sail maker, as a matter of fact, I mean, there's actually an image of that. Describe that for me, because that really becomes sort of famous. I mean,
the sail maker was one of her favorite prints, and it's a gentleman called Downs Curtis, and he and his brother Albert Curtis were very, very handsome. And they were portrayed in Ebony Magazine, I think it was in 1961. Albert Curtis was married to Mrs. Frances Curtis, who's sitting here now. And his brother Downs was trained by a sailmaker.
A real sailmaker.
A real sailmaker, absolutely. And it's interesting that he, in the studies we have for the print, Ruth Starr Rose has sketches of the person who was training Downs Curtis in the same position as Downs Curtis. She just used them interchangeably, but when she chose to do the lithograph, she focused on Downs Curtis. And he's someone who's completely lost in his art and is very much at peace with what he's doing. The studio in which he's working is extremely well organized. That studio exists to this day, and it's just a time capsule of someone who's an artist and that moment where they're completely focused on their work.
Now, there's also one picture in which I guess it looks as if it's a woman who's sitting at a table, looks like it's the end of the day. I think you know the one. And the thing that struck me, and we had this conversation before, is that you could sort of see that it's been a very long day and this is kind of the end of it. Describe that for me.
So that's a lithograph. It's called Supper Time. And there was a woman kind of just gazing into space, very calm, very quiet, at peace. But her plate is empty, and the shelves behind her are quite bare. I mean, there's a beautiful sort of silver teapot, but it's kind of on its own. And it's really talking about, I think it's showing empathy for how exhausting it is to be in service to other people and how little is left over for oneself at the end of a long day.
So now we want to sort of move to this to what is sort of paintings in terms of the religious paintings that she put. She apparently she went to the local African-American church, and she's been described, in fact, some of the paintings and some of the drawings and so on that's been described as some of the best representation of Negro spirituals. How did she become involved with this particular church? Do we know? What was that relationship like?
Well, the Copperville Church was one of three historic churches in Talbot County, where land was given to founding families who risked their lives showing support for the Union troops. And so her mother actually attended the Sunday school sort of around 1907, 1908 at Copperville. And Ruth Starr Rose ended up teaching Sunday school, we know, in 1940. But she was definitely involved before that time. And she, again, just connected to the straightforward message of the people in that congregation, and again told her friends, I'm not doing anything original. I just want to know what is in their heart and their soul when they're singing Ezekiel Saw the Wheel or Swing Low Sweet Chariot or the Old Arks of Moverin. And one of the things that happens again and again that we see is the circle or a wheel. And we're learning that that actually has relevance with the archaeological excavations at Y House, where they're unearthing what we call spirit bundles, where there are these circles again and again.
That.
We've known for a while that the spirituals are, if it's possible to have something that's more important than the portraits in terms of a discovery, the spirituals are possibly even more important because she got right into the minds of the people in the congregation and just was just logging things faithfully. It's very much similar to what the Charleston Poetry Society was doing around that same time, where they were going down, traveling down dirt roads, people like Josephine Pinckney, the writer, or DeBose Hayward, and recording the lyrics of people singing in small churches. But in her case, she recorded the lyrics, but also the visuals. That's where her work is even a greater departure from what others were doing. And she would record an image again and again until she got it right. And they would say, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong. So an example would be the minister of the Copperville Church lost his son in training for World War II. He was probably a diver, which would have made sense coming from the Eastern Shore. And she created a color lithograph, a black and white lithograph, and a huge fresco honoring this man's son for his service. And that ceremony that she had in the Copperville Church, she sent all the information again to her friends in New York saying, we honored people who came before us, black and white. And she thanked the gentleman in New York for loaning the Paul Robeson recording of Pharaoh's Army Got Drowned. And this is recorded in the Christian Science Monitor as being the first work of art that a white person ever made for a black church. Mm. And the fresco has survived.
Now, my understanding is that that she would come back again and again, talk about, you know, whether or not this painting was right. And there was an issue about white angels and black angels. And tell us a little bit about that.
In Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, she makes beautiful black and white lithograph where she's showing us the Copperville Church and the other historic church, the Unionville Church. She's faithfully depicting them. That's used in the New York Times Book Review. Then she makes a color lithograph that's really quite different, but they all have these wheels and kind of swirling motion of angels coming down in an old car. Mm-hmm. And the congregation is on the ground. So we find there's an oil painting that happens a little bit later, and it's quite similar to the color lithograph. However, the angel is white. And so we found notes, and actually in the Christian Science Monitor, she talks about how it was slightly depressing to her that they corrected her in the end, saying, actually, that you have to portray the angel as being white. And she was ironic about that, but it's pretty clear that she felt sad that that would be their image.
Hmm. So describe for Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, describe what the painting looks like.
The painting?
Yeah.
Well, she wrote that it was meant to be a car called a Dayton that people drove around in, and it's coming down from the sky to bring one's loved one back to heaven. And so in the painting, it's a white angel on the Dayton, coming down to this very flat land that's clearly the eastern shore to rescue a congregation, a waiting congregation. And in the color lithograph, it's pretty much the same, except that there are very beautiful, youthful black angels. So in other spirituals, what I like, and she does them later, there's one called Hear the Wondrous Word of the Lord, or Judgment Day, and that's actually called the Negro Battle Hymn. Came from a beautiful story in Maryland. And in that lithograph, she's showing a black angel and a white angel together. So she has another beautiful serigraph or silkscreen she does called Peace, and it's a white angel and a black angel sort of shaking hands.
Now, one of the things that observed was that she did not seem to be looking at, obviously, the ugly side of the period, which was obviously the Jim Crow, and she had, as a matter of fact, there was the famous lynching in the 1930s, but she was exhibiting at the time. Tell us a little bit about that, and one would think that it would be dangerous.
She was incredibly brave, but she was incapable of being negative. She was just not happening. Well, the lynching was in October of 1933 in Princess Anne. It ended up kind of dragging the Salisbury back to Princess Anne, in which 2,000 National Guard were deployed to control a white mob that had lynched a man, George Armwood, who is reported to have special needs. So at the same time, Mencken is writing a story called Rebels in Transchoptankia, was his reaction. And he just said, I'm going to rename that part of the Eastern Shore Transchoptankia. You know, we have to move on here. And so a Baltimore Sun truck couldn't come over to the Eastern Shore without being stoned by the local people. And so at the same time, she went ahead and had her solo show in Baltimore. It was the last solo show that she had before the show we just did at the Lewis Museum. And it featured mostly these large oil portraits of her friends who were people of color. So it was incredibly brave. We went through the newspaper clippings and we thought it was kind of odd. I didn't understand what was happening on the Eastern Shore when I started this quest. And I thought, why can't the press get her name straight? Why aren't they really saying where she lives? Well, they were protecting her and her family from her neighbors who were racists, I suppose. Right. But she was just incapable of even acknowledging people like that existed. She was just, it just made her that much closer to the people whom she believed in.
I mean, does that, in one sense, alienate her from what obviously was a growing movement, a civil rights movement? I know there was a great deal. I mean, there was some fallout between Hurston, the writer, and how she approached portraying African Americans, which is a very positive light, as opposed to that interaction that, say, for instance, Richard Wright, for instance, would write. I mean, there seems to be two things that are going on simultaneously in terms of how the African American writer and painters and so on are looking at their world.
Hmm. Well, she's certainly a very important part of that dialogue, because by 1940, Alan Locke does the book called The Negro in Art, and she's close enough to him that he selects two of her works for that book. And within 6 months, she's meeting Paul Robeson at a concert in Newark, New Jersey, and she presented him with two of her, again, spirituals, Little David, mm-hmm. Play Upon Your Harp, and Ezekiel Saw the Wheel. So it's encouraging Robeson, who's definitely under investigation,
right,
at this point, to pursue his dream, and honoring him as a visionary by comparing him to subjects of very important spirituals in the Black community. So she seems to be... She seems to be, pretty much every step of the way, she's in sync with a larger international audience.
All right. I ran across one painting, or picture anyway, of, it's a soldier. It was written, I think it was painted in the late 1940s. And he's looking on. There's a house that's burning, and it looks like his wife and children are hugging around him. That seems to be a recognition of
sacrifice.
Discord, yeah.
Yeah. Again, most artists would make maybe one image to honor a soldier of color during World War II. This artist, 14 depictions. Mm. And the one to which you refer is called Nobody Knows the Trouble I See. When we look at the studies for that painting, there's a woman who's sitting on a chair ascending to heaven. She's presumably died in fire in her home. Her husband's children are hugging him in front of the burning house while the animals are all running around. And the statement is clear. He's gone off to fight war, and she's at home raising the family, and so she's perished. And a quite well-known artist actually saw those studies, and when he saw this 24-by-36-inch study of the woman ascending heaven in the chair, he said to me, who is the black artist doing sort of John Singer Sargent? So so it was wonderful to tell him he was completely wrong, because, of course, as a great artist, he knows everything.
Right. So what is it, do you think, as a contribution to the Eastern Shore, these paintings are? I mean, obviously, they have significance beyond us. But what do they tell us, do you think, about life back then and what she appreciated?
I think it's when people talk about September 11th and they all tell you it was a beautiful day, and it was a beautiful day. And I think in the most difficult times, we find the most beautiful people and the best behavior. It's almost a reaction to that. So I feel that's what we can say about the Eastern Shore.
Mm-hmm.
We've stepped up to the plate. You know, we acknowledge this history and we move on. But the international significance of this story is becoming clearer to us, because we just don't have a lot to compare it to.
Well, we were speaking with Barbara Pecas. She is the curator of this excellent collection, remarkable collection, really, of paintings, lithographs by Ruth Starr Rose. She was an Eastern Shore artist who brought the lives of African Americans who lived on here to life. And we appreciate also Ms. Frances Curtis, a descendant of Harriet Tubman, also related to the family that was also painted. We appreciate you stopping by and chatting with us.
Yeah.
This has been Delmarva Today. I'm Don Rush. Thanks for listening.
Thank you for watching Delmarva Today, a production of Delmarva Public Radio. Production and audio engineering by Chris Frank. Hosted by Don Rush. For podcasts, visit DelmarvaPublicRadio.net or subscribe to the Delmarva Today podcast on iTunes. Delmarva Today can now be seen on Pack 14. For the Delmarva Today schedule, visit pac14.org or view the latest issue of the Daily Times.